Random House Audio presents The Third Chimpanzee, The Evolution and Future of the Human Animal by Jared Diamond, read for you by Rob Shapiro. Theme: How the human species changed within a short time from just another species of big mammal to a world conqueror, and how we acquired the capacity to reverse all that progress overnight. Prologue. It's obvious that humans are unlike all animals. It's also obvious that we're a species of big mammal, down to the minutest details of our anatomy and our molecules. That contradiction is the most fascinating feature of the human species. It's familiar, but we still have difficulty grasping how it came to be and what it means. On the one hand, between us and all other species lies a seemingly unbridgeable gulf that we acknowledge by defining a category called animals. It implies that we consider centipedes, chimpanzees, and clams to share decisive features with each other but not with us, and to lack features restricted to us. Among those unique characteristics of ours, we talk, write, and build complex machines. We depend on tools, not on our bare hands, to make a living. Most of us wear clothes and enjoy art, and many of us believe in a religion. We are distributed over the whole earth, command much of its energy and production, and are beginning to expand into the ocean depths and into space. We're also unique in darker behaviors, including genocide, delight in torture, addiction to toxic drugs, and extermination of other species by the thousands. While a few animal species have one or two of these behaviors in rudimentary form, like tool use, we still far eclipse animals even in those respects. Thus, for practical and legal purposes, humans aren't considered animals. When Darwin proposed in 1859 that we had evolved from apes, it's no wonder that most people initially regarded his theory as absurd and continued to insist that we had been separately created by God. Many people, including a quarter of all American college graduates, still hold to that belief today. But on the other hand, we obviously are animals, with the usual animal body parts, molecules, and genes. It's even clear what particular type of animal we are. Externally, we're so similar to chimpanzees that 18th century anatomists who believed in divine creation could already recognize our affinities. Just imagine taking some normal people, stripping off their clothes, taking away all their other possessions, depriving them of the power of speech, and reducing them to grunting without changing their anatomy at all. Put them in a cage in the zoo next to the chimp cages, and let the rest of us clothed and talking people visit the zoo. Those speechless caged people would be seen for what we all really are: chimps that have little hair and walk upright. A zoologist from outer space would immediately classify us as just a third species of chimpanzee, along with the pygmy chimp of Zaire and the common chimp of the rest of tropical Africa. Molecular genetic studies of the last half dozen years have shown that we continue to share over 98% of our genetic program with the other two chimps. The overall genetic distance between us and chimps is even smaller than the distance between such closely related bird species as red-eyed and white-eyed vireos. Thus, we still carry most of our old biological baggage with us. Since Darwin's time, fossilized bones of hundreds of creatures variously intermediate between apes and modern humans have been discovered, making it impossible for a reasonable person to deny the overwhelming evidence. What once seemed absurd, our evolution from apes, actually happened. Yet the discoveries of many missing links have only made the problem more fascinating, without fully solving it. The few bits of new baggage we acquired, the 2% difference between our genes and those of chimps, must have been responsible for all of our seemingly unique properties. We underwent some small changes with big consequences rather quickly and recently in our evolutionary history. In fact, As recently as 100,000 years ago, that zoologist from outer space would have viewed us as just one more species of big mammal. Granted, we had a couple of curious behaviors, notably our control of fire and our dependence on tools, but those behaviors would have seemed no more curious to the extraterrestrial visitor than would the behaviors of beavers and bowerbirds. Somehow, within a few tens of thousands of years, a period that is almost infinitely long when measured against one person's memory, but is only a tiny fraction of our species' separate history, we had begun to demonstrate the qualities that make us unique and fragile. What were those few key ingredients that made us human? Since our unique properties appeared so recently and involved so few changes, those properties, or at least their precursors, must already be present in animals. What are those animal precursors of art and language, of genocide and drug abuse? Our unique qualities have been responsible for our present biological success as a species. No other large animal is native to all the continents, or breeds in all habitats from deserts and the Arctic to tropical rainforests. No large wild animal rivals us in numbers. But among our unique qualities are two that now jeopardize our existence: our propensities to kill each other and to destroy our environment. Of course, both propensities occur in other species. Lions and many other animals kill their own kind, while elephants and others damage their environment. However, these propensities are much more threatening in us than in other animals because of our technological power and exploding numbers. There's nothing new about prophecies to the effect that the world's end is near if we don't repent. What's new is that this prophecy is now likely to come true for two obvious reasons. First, nuclear weapons give us the means to wipe ourselves out quickly. No humans possessed this means before. Second, we already appropriate about 40% of the Earth's net productivity, i.e., the net energy captured from sunlight. With the world's human population now doubling every 41 years, we soon shall reach the biological limit to growth, at which point we shall have to start fighting each other in dead earnest for a share of the world's fixed pie of resources. In addition, given the present rate at which we are exterminating species, most of the world's species will become extinct or endangered within the next century. But we depend on many species for our own life support. Why rehearse these familiar depressing facts? And why try to trace the animal origins of our destructive qualities? If they really are part of our evolutionary heritage, that seems to say that they are genetically fixed and hence unchangeable. In fact, our situation is not hopeless. Perhaps the urge to murder strangers or sexual rivals is innate in us, but that still hasn't prevented human societies from attempting to thwart those instincts and from succeeding in sparing most people the fate of being murdered. Even taking two world wars into account, proportionately far fewer people have died violent deaths in 20th century industrialized states than in Stone Age tribal societies. Many modern populations enjoy longer lifespans than did humans of the past. Environmentalists don't always lose in battles with developers and destroyers. Even some genetic infirmities, such as phenylketonuria and juvenile onset diabetes, can now be mitigated or cured. My purpose in rehearsing our situation is to help us avoid repeating our mistakes, to use knowledge of our past and our propensities in order to change our behavior. That's the hope behind the dedication of this book. My twin sons were born in 1987 and will reach my present age in the year 2041. What we are doing now is shaping their world. It is not the goal of this book to propose specific solutions to our predicament, because the solutions we should adopt are already clear in broad outline. Some of those solutions include halting population growth, limiting or eliminating nuclear weapons, developing peaceful means for solving international disputes, reducing our impact on the environment and preserving species and natural habitats. Many excellent books make detailed proposals for how to carry out these policies. Some of these policies are being implemented in some cases now. We just need to implement them consistently. If we all became convinced...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.